So I am on my way to Kissimmee Prairie Preserve State Park again. I'm looking forward to shooting some tracked astrophotography tonight. Previously, when I was there just about a month ago, I shot with the Sigma 20mm f1.4 and 24mm f1.4, two really great lenses. I really enjoyed using those. This time, I'm back with some more Sigma gear. I'll be using the Sigma FP and FPL camera bodies. These are some pretty weird and unusual camera bodies. They're sort of these like really compact, full frame, kind of geared more towards cinema camera bodies. The Sigma FP is a 24 megapixel and the FPL is a 61 megapixel. I think they're both Sony sensors, so it's about what you would expect from like an A7 Mark III and an A7R Mark IV or something like that. But what I'm actually interested in for tonight is doing tracked astrophotography. So I have a really compact astrophotography tracker that I'm going to be using. It's the Move Shoot Move tracker. So I've got about an hour to go on my drive, and there's lots of clouds everywhere. I'm definitely hopeful that it'll be clear by the time I get there, and you know, we can get set up. I'll also be arriving kind of right around twilight. So if there's anybody else set up there, you know, hopefully I can kind of get in there and not disturb anybody who's already shooting, keep my lights off and stuff like that. So I just pulled into my spot at Kissimmee Prairie. They have designated astropaths, which are basically just campsites, but they have power and some outlets and stuff, so you can hook up astrophotography equipment like computers and stuff like that. So that's kind of a cool thing about this place, is it's just built to be astrophotography friendly, which is really, really neat. And I'm the only one here. It's quite dark except for the moon. Right now we have a waxing gibbous moon, probably around like 60 or 70% illuminated. So that's going to be up for most of the night until about 1:40, and then the moon will set and we should get some dark skies between then and sunrise, and you know, that should make it really nice to do some astrophotography. I know there's probably a whole ton of bugs out right now, so I'm going to try and do what I can in the car without having to get out, you know, just get everything ready and, you know, put on my pants and long sleeves and stuff like that.
All right, so here's the Move Shoot Move with the FPL and the 85mm. I don't have the dew heater plugged in just yet, but I should probably go ahead and do that.
While the moon was still up, I spent most of my time getting my tracker polar aligned and getting familiar with the Sigma FP and FPL. When I first handled these cameras after Sigma sent me some loaners to test, I was initially surprised by their stout build quality. They feel exceptionally nicely built, and I think the modular design of these cameras is a fresh take on the idea of a camera. Without any accessories, the FP is basically a digital camera distilled down to its most basic parts. It uses an electronic shutter and electronic image stabilization, so there's no internal moving parts on the FP. It's essentially just a lens mount, a sensor, and an LCD screen. If you want anything extra like a viewfinder or a hand grip, you need to attach them via numerous threaded hardpoints on each side of the camera body. There are already a ton of videos out there that better cover the FP and FPL user interface, performance, and features, but I tried to keep my eye out for any features on these Sigma cameras that might have been particularly useful for astrophotography or landscape astrophotography. One of the things that initially had me interested was that the FP and FPL have some of the best dynamic range throughout the ISO range, according to photons to photos, and that means they should have better noise performance than most of their peers. Now, just like how the physical features of this camera are distilled down to the bare essentials, the same goes for the software-based features. So while the FP has everything you might need to make a successful astrophoto, it's missing some of the simple conveniences that I've come to love from my Sony cameras for landscape astrophotography. The FP and FPL don't have anything similar to the bright monitoring feature of my Sony's for assisting with composition in very dark conditions. With a fast f1.4 lens, its live view feed is still usable, but it's nothing like what my Sony a7C shows with bright monitoring enabled. The FP and FPL have a built-in interval timer function, but it strangely doesn't allow you to set any specific number of frames greater than 99 shots. You can still set it to shoot indefinitely, but I much prefer being able to define exactly how many frames to shoot. For example, sometimes I want to be able to capture exactly 240 shots to capture just the right number of frames for a 10-second time lapse. I did like that I could use the FPL's crop zoom function in cinema mode to dramatically zoom in on a target star and be able to very precisely focus, and that's something that made it super nice when focusing with my Sharp Star 2 focusing filter. One of the biggest things that I felt was missing from both the FP and FPL was an articulating LCD screen. I thought that the accessory flip-up EVF would be potentially just as nice, but it doesn't quite get there. It's generally very nice to look through, but with the need to flip a switch on the side of the camera body just to switch from the LCD screen to the viewfinder, it just didn't have the same convenience factor of an articulating LCD. Beyond those small things, the Sigma FP and FPL were actually quite nice to use once I got them configured, and I honestly spent more of my time fiddling with my star tracker than the Sigma cameras.
Alright, so after I got my polar alignment set, I tried turning on the tracker, and I was actually getting like an error from it. It was just blinking the north to south indicator, just back and forth and back and forth. But what I did was I plugged it into my little USB power pack, and that seemed to clear up the error. It goes back if I unplug it, but it seems like I'm going to have it plugged in. I don't know if somehow the battery got drained or something like that, or maybe the battery's failing on it, but while it's powered with external power, it seems to work. But I'm glad I think I figured it out. I'm gonna check it out and take some test shots, and you know, hopefully everything works well. So it seems like the tracker's doing just fine now that I plugged it into power. The moon is still pretty high up in the sky, so I know I'm not really gonna get any like Milky Way or anything right now. So I'm just kind of doing some test shots. If my alignment's pretty good, then I know that I can do relatively long exposures with the tracker. If it isn't so good, I'll dial it back down a little bit until I can maintain like pinpoint stars. So that's kind of the trick with this, is a tracker really depends on how good of a polar alignment you can get. And for this one, you know, I'm just using that green laser, pointing it at the North Star. It's not super precise, but you know, it kind of gets the job done. It should get it pretty close. So hopefully that'll dial it in enough that I can get some relatively long exposures.
So while the moon was still out, I re-aimed my cameras toward the moon and started some time lapses.
There's the moon behind me. It's just setting. And I'm still gonna run my time lapses for a little bit. I kind of like the light and what's going on in them. The moon's kind of going behind some clouds, so hopefully we'll get some good colors in the time lapse. And then after that, I'll probably grab the Sigma FP with a 20mm, walk around and shoot with that one.
The moon was bright enough that the Milky Way was nearly completely obscured, but I did have a decent view of some distant thunderstorms as the moon approached the horizon. Once the moon was set, I shot a few time lapses of M31, the Andromeda Galaxy, both tracked and untracked, with the FPL and the 85mm. In total, I recorded 12 minutes of exposures for each of my tracked and untracked sequences. Because of the rotation of the Earth, all of my untracked exposures were limited to 4 seconds before star trails became too detrimental, and even then, with the 61 megapixel sensor of the FPL, my 4-second exposures still showed some tangible star trailing. By contrast, the Move Shoot Move tracker allowed me to capture a full 30 seconds per exposure without any noticeable star trails. Now, this exercise really showed the value in combining the 61 megapixel resolution of the FPL, the 85 millimeter lens, and the star tracker. It was possible to substantially crop the final image and still maintain enough resolution that it could almost pass for being shot on a much longer telescope. Beside the obvious resolution advantage of using a star tracker, one of the biggest benefits was being able to capture fewer total exposures. For 12 minutes of total exposure time, I only needed to shoot 24 exposures on the Move Shoot Move tracker. And by contrast, I had to capture 180 exposures when shooting without the tracker. Shortly after, the constellation Orion started to rise on the eastern horizon, so I framed it up with the FPL. In total, I captured about 48 minutes of tracked exposures of Orion, but because of fairly high humidity conditions and moderately strong airglow, I still had some difficulty processing this set of images. Even so, Orion is a treasure trove in the night sky with a tremendous number of interesting objects to capture, and I was very surprised by how much fine detail I was able to capture with just an 85mm lens and the Sigma FPL. While the FPL was shooting time lapses on the tracker, I roamed around separately with the FP and the 20mm. Personally, I still prefer this simpler kind of shooting, just a camera, a tripod, and more freedom to compose without worrying about polar alignment. For each composition, I use the FP's interval timer function to shoot about 16 exposures before moving on to another. So while these shots aren't tracked, the extra exposures can still be combined in Starry Landscape Stacker for a decent reduction in noise. Just before sunrise, when my first set of camera batteries started to run out, I packed up the gear and started to drive back out of the park. And I almost decided to leave, but when a light fog started to roll in, I decided to stick around and shoot some more compositions with the FP and the 20mm.
Sun's coming out and there's like a really cool low fog that's just kind of hanging over the prairie. Looking out for little compositions, I found this stand of palm trees that I'm shooting right now. I'm shooting sort of like a time-lapse stack of it. It's like real quiet right now, just the sound of some bugs, and you can kind of look and either direction, and there's just nothing forever, at least that's what it looks like. I can see some distant thunderstorms on the horizon. So I'm hoping for some good morning light, and then I'll make my way back home right after sunrise.
Being out before sunrise is one of the great privileges of photography. It's often so easy to miss this opportunity, to hit the snooze button and get that extra hour of sleep. But nearly every time I've made the effort to be awake for sunrise, it's been worth it. While I rarely think it in the moment, I'd so much rather trade some sleep to be present, as it seems, as the only person on Earth watching it wake up.
That's a really nice morning. There's thunderstorms in the distance, the fog, and as the sun came up, it was pretty cool. It started to light up the prairie, and all of the grasses of the prairie are covered in spider webs. There's just like thousands and thousands of spider webs, like basically as far as the eye can see, all being lit up by the sun. They all have like dewdrops on them. So that was kind of a really neat sight. So the really nice morning light is just starting to go away. So I think that's about my cue to get out of here and drive back home.
I learned a few things on this outing. I think this time shooting at Kissimmee Prairie really demonstrated how better gear can improve photography. My shots of Orion and Andromeda were made dramatically better by both the use of the Move Shoot Move tracker and the super high resolution sensor of the Sigma FPL. That said, what ultimately stuck with me on this trip wasn't how great the gear performed, but rather how much I enjoyed the process of shooting with it. Initially, little annoyances like power issues, polar alignment, and the added complexity of lugging a star tracker in my kit were all things that distracted from the experience of being in this beautiful place. I realized that I only truly started enjoying the night once I started to roam around with a simpler kit without the star tracker. And since this was my second time at Kissimmee Prairie, my familiarity with the park opened up a whole new level of comfort, and I found so much more satisfaction in quickly moving around the place to find multiple compositions that really showcased my memory of being in this place at night.